In the past, we all thought the future of cooking would be like adding a drop of water to a pill and poof, a turkey dinner. Well, it's 2015 and the closest we've got is a cup of noodles. So while we scale back our visions of just add water food pills, what does the future of cooking actually look like? Hey guys, Julia here for DNews. For most of human history, cooking required raw ingredients and applied heat, usually in the form of fire. And all that peeling and slicing, boiling and baking and cooking took a lot of time. Not to mention just heating up a pot of water meant heating up the whole fire or stove, which heated up the whole kitchen or house, so cooking was laborious and time intensive. Then inventions like the refrigerator and microwave changed everything. The countertop microwave hit the scene in 1967, and suddenly dinner could be ready in a matter of minutes. So it's been nearly 50 years since then. How would a kitchen 50 years from now look? The former CTO of Microsoft came out with a high-tech, high-price-tag cookbook of the almost future. Many of the recipes and suggestions in modernist cuisine are currently used by chefs in very fancy kitchens, but they're mostly out of reach for the average Joe. But it's certainly fun to look into what happens when a scientist steps into the kitchen. The most within reach of the things he talks about is a recent trend sweeping cooking in the Western world. It's sous vide cooking. This is essentially slow cooking food by vacuum sealing it in plastic bags and placing the bags in a temperature-controlled water bath. When I say slow, I mean really slow, a few days at least. This keeps the meat evenly cooked throughout, so it's not overcooked on the outside and undercooked in the middle. It also keeps the moisture in. My old roommates actually used a thing like this to cook their food. It was pretty tasty. The book also suggests some tools you're more likely to see in a scientific lab than in a kitchen. Homogenizers and centrifuges, and even liquid nitrogen. The liquid nitrogen is used to cryo-fry meat and vegetables. A quick dunk in the liquid nitrogen tank before it goes in the fryer makes the outside of food hot and crisp, but doesn't overcook the middle. Industrial kitchen-sized centrifuges can cost tens of thousands of dollars, and they basically look like a typical washing machine. But instead of a spin cycle for your dirty jeans, it can puree peas. If you've ever used one of the tabletop versions in a lab, you know pretty much what a centrifuge can do. It spins the peas or whatever you want so fast that it actually separates the different layers of juice, starch, and fat. And even the blender, a steady kitchen staple, gets an update in modernist cooking. A rotostator homogenizer, again, something you're used to in a lab, can suck up your ingredients, spin them around really fast, and shoot them back out through holes located in the tip. Basically, it mixes better and blends food better and smoother than traditional blenders. While many of these gadgets already exist and are used frequently in scientific labs, high-tech and high-quality chefs are bringing them into the kitchen. Even writer Corby Coomer, who reviewed the modernist cuisine for the MIT Technology Review, said that he came away convinced that these techniques and ingredients will be essential for cooks of the future. But the modernist cuisine is just one look into the future. Other companies and organizations get all heated up when thinking about the kitchens of the 21st century. And beyond. Innit, a new company that manages and connects food information, are designing what they call the self-driving car of ovens. It's a broiler, baking, convection, and microwave oven all in one. The oven knows what food you've put in it, knows exactly how long to cook it thanks to built-in sensors. But the sensors don't stop there. Sensors in your fridge could tell you exactly what you have in there, how long it's been sitting there, and how to turn those ingredients into the perfect meal. And even your cutting board will be covered in sensors. It could tell you how to chop that tomato and what sort of recipes will go along with it. While these inventions could help making cooking for people like me a little easier, they also cut down on waste. I always leave cucumbers in the back of the fridge and forget about them for a week, so I wind up throwing them out. But if my fridge had a sensor on it, it could remind me of the food that's been sitting there for a while and how exactly to best use that food now that it's a little softer than it should be. While some of us take our modern kitchens and even our microwaves for granted, other places in the world struggle to have basics like electricity and still use open fire to cook. Be sure to check out our other episode over on Seeker Stories, where we discovered how constant blackouts and a lack of electricity in general impacts life in Tanzania.
I'm here in Tanzania because sub-Saharan Africa is experiencing a major energy crisis, leaving hundreds of millions of people in the dark.
To learn more about energy poverty, visit one.org/energy. So what sort of gadget would you like to see in your kitchen in the future? Tell us down in the comments below. Don't forget to hit those like and subscribe buttons if you're not a subscriber already. And keep coming back to DNews. We've got new episodes every day of the week.